Okay, so in the last lecture, I tried to go through the three basic kinds of superconductive qubit, which have been used over the last 15 years or so in the quantum information field. Remember, there was the phase qubit, which is basically a simple Josephson junction biased by an external current. There's the triad qubit, which is essentially a small superconducting island to which you can transfer a Cooper pair, not transfer it, because it's in two basis states. And finally, there's the flux qubit, which is what used to be called an RF squid, that is a simple superconducting ring interrupted by, well, in the simplest case, by a single Josephson junction. And these all, they all have to be discussed in some sense, so rather differently. But one thing that's, one problem that's common to all these types of qubit is, of course, the generic decoherence problem. So, for example, if I have a charge qubit, then I'm going to be controlling it, or going to try to control it, partially at least, by the gate voltage applied to the island relative to the bulk superconductor. And the problem is that because of random charges which may be situated in the environment, that gate voltage is likely to fluctuate. For a phase qubit, similarly, the bias current, again, is something that you like to use as a parameter, but that may fluctuate. In addition, you have an additional problem with the phase qubit, that in the simple theory, one treats the critical current as a fixed object, but in fact, it may well itself fluctuate. That's because typically you may get various kinds of defect, two different systems in the junction, and depending on the position of your two different defect, critical current may change. So it's an additional source of error in that case.
Can you turn your microphone on?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, I probably need to turn
on. There we go.
Okay, thanks. Right. And similarly, in the case of the flux qubit, there are going to be various sources of unwanted fluctuating external flux which may hit you. So generally speaking, we can assume that our control, so-called control parameter lambda, consists of something which we actually intend, and then some delta lambda, which is the effect of the fluctuations of the environment. If we project that description onto the qubit space, then we have a Hamiltonian for our qubit, which can be separated, again, into two parts. There's the intended part, which involves the intended control parameter here, and then there'll be some fluctuating part. Now, very generally, since we are dealing with a two-dimensional Hilbert space, we can express the situation in the language of pseudospins and pseudomagnetic fields. And so the generic fluctuating Hamiltonian, apart from, of course, there's going to be maybe a term proportional to the unit operator, but of course we can forget that, that's not going to hurt us. Apart from that, we're going to have a term which can always be expressed in the form of the pseudo-spin operator sigma dotted into some pseudo-magnetic field, which represents the effect of the fluctuating environment. And as we saw in earlier lectures, the fluctuating field can quite generically be parameterized by three quantities, Ji of omega, corresponding to the three
different components of sigma. And these, this Ji of omega, I won't bother to write it out, but it's a, it can be expressed as in terms of the matrix elements of the environment and the density states of the environment. And it turns out, very fortunately, that that one function does actually encapsulate the complete effect of the environment. Now, in the standard language of NMR, we know that the effect of delta H generally, though not always, can be expressed in terms of two relaxation rates, T1 to the minus 1, T2 to the minus 1, or gamma 1 and gamma 2. gamma 1 is the so-called longitudinal relaxation time in NMR language. In quantum information language, it's the probability per unit time of a bit flip. And that is given by the x and y components of J at the frequency corresponding to the transition between your two states. That, I think, is fairly obvious. If the system makes the transition, it has to emit or absorb energy from the environment, and therefore the environment has to change its energy by that frequency. Gamma 2 is a little more tricky. The rate gamma 2 contains two parts. One is half of gamma 1. The second, so-called gamma phi, the pure dephasing term, comes from the fluctuations of the environment, which are, in the language of pseudospins, they're along the z-axis. In other words, they modulate the relative energies here. And that's dangerous because however low the frequency is, that's still going to give you an effect. And so, so in general, this will depend on the limit of jz. I don't know if you can read this, but it should be a jz here. Jz in the limit that omega goes to zero. And it's been a matter of experience that, generally speaking, when dealing with qubits for quantum information purposes, you tend to find that it is this particular contribution corresponding to gamma phi here which is the most dangerous. For example, in many systems, you get something which looks at least vaguely like 1 over f noise. That has a rather large spectral weight at low frequencies, so that is going to detune you rather seriously. So in most cases, indeed, it is this term which is the most dangerous, but that term only couples through the z component of spin, and therefore what we would ideally like is that there's no sigma z coupling. That is, we want dE by d lambda equal to zero. On the other hand, of course, this is going to be a bit of a problem, since it was lambda that we wanted to use as the control parameter. So we have this ambiguity here. Incidentally, on general references for this lecture, there are a few fairly good recent review articles. This one by Zhong et al. In Chinese Physics is actually a rather good review, I think, of recent work on decoherence and readout. This one is a little more specialist, Yeo et al. This is about really about hybrid hybrid systems involving superconductors and other kinds of system, like, say, atomic spins, and so forth. This one, Divere and Shulkov, I think is very very readable recent review, I think March of 2013, and does, I think, give some very interesting speculations about the direction in which the field is going to go forward. I think that's rather a recommendable one. Okay. So in other words, as I say, we want, as far as possible, that dE by Q should be zero. For flux qubits, we want the sensitivity to the external flux to be zero, etc. Now, these one, actually one rather easy and obvious way to achieve this. If our original Hamiltonian was given in the following form, which is basically the Hamiltonian of a simple harmonic oscillator shifted by some origin, as it were. That is, it's, the control parameter in this case is the origin of the oscillator potential. Then you automatically achieve the result you want, because all the energy level differences, although the absolute energy can depend on lambda, well, actually, even that's not true with this form of the interaction. All the energy level differences are indeed independent of lambda. However, unfortunately, that just brings us back to our old friend, the simple harmonic oscillator, and so there's no truncation to a two-qubit system. And so our basic problem is how to minimize sensitivity to the environmental fluctuations while maintaining enough anharmonicity to justify a truncation to a two-dimensional Hilbert space. And this is essentially the problem that various designs over the last 10 or 15 years have tried to meet. Okay, so the first one, elaborate design in this field was the so-called quantronium design, which was invented by the Saclay group in, I think, 2002. And that was, I think, a fairly major step forward in the field. What you have here is basically a Cooper pair box. So it's essentially a charged qubit here, but it is incorporated. So here, I mean, if you forget about this for the moment, then this is just a standard Cooper pair box with the bulk superconductor being out here, and the island, as usually, is gated by a gate voltage. But now the improvement is that this is now incorporated as part of a circuit which contains a much stronger Josephson junction than the two junctions actually forming the island here. Incidentally, one point to note is that, if necessary, these junctions themselves can be essentially a DC squid type, so that you can actually adjust the strength of the critical current by tuning the magnetic field. Now, in this setup, you normally regards the quantity gamma as the quantities gamma and delta as classical and related by this standard relation here, which is the standard relation for a completely superconducting circuit containing threaded by magnetic flux. So the magnetic flux again is here is regarded as a purely classical control parameter. The quantity theta, which is the average phase difference between the island and the rest of the circuit, is regarded as quantum mechanical. Now, if you tune your flux, or alternatively your bias current here, so as to ensure that delta, the quantity delta, which is this is the difference in phase differences across the two junctions. If that's zero, then both the total current across the island and the total current into it are zero. The two energy eigenstates, in that case, respectively have theta equals zero and theta equals pi. If you now tune delta to be non-zero, then the current into the island is still zero, but the current across it, that is the current around the circuit, is not. It's given by this expression here. And that can take two values corresponding to the even odd combinations of n and n plus 1 here. Now, notice that when V sub G is tuned to the degeneracy point, that is the point at which the charging energy corresponding to N and N plus 1 is the same, then the eigenstates in the N basis are these. And so the low frequency fluctuations, for example, the fluctuations of the gate charge, are particularly ineffective. That's because if this is the if these are the energy eigenstates, then if you take the standard representation in which sigma z corresponds to the energy eigenstates, as I did previously, then in that basis, these charge fluctuations couple only to sigma x, not sigma z, and therefore they do give you a gamma 2. Yes.
What do you mean? I'm sorry, I'm still stuck. What do you mean? You say the current of the island is zero, but the current across it is non-zero.
Okay, the total current flowing into the island is still zero. In fact, in some sense, it's rather obvious it has to be, because if it were not, then something is changing in time, so you can't be in an energy eigenstate.
Okay.
But the current, the sum of the currents here, in from here, and in from here, is zero, but the current across it stops it. We get a non-zero gamma 2, but it's only through the gamma 1 over 2 terms, not so dangerous. Provided that gamma and phi are both zero, then the energy is insensitive. If gamma and phi are both zero, then delta is zero. The energy is now insensitive to fluctuations of phi. So you've got yourself a situation where, at least with a particular choice of the control parameters, to first order, you're insensitive both to fluctuations in the gate charge, or the random charge on the gate, and also to fluctuations of flux through the circuit.
Assume that a small fluctuation of flux, right? Because you're doing that assumption, but you're saying, you know, gamma and phi are zero, then the energy insensitive fluctuations of phi. But if phi fluctuates around zero, then it's no longer zero, and so it is sensitive to fluctuations.
It's sensitive, but only to first order,
second order.
Yep. Okay, now the one apparent problem, of course, with this this setup is that, fine, you've got yourself to a situation where essentially all the control parameters, you're insensitive to fluctuations in any of the control parameters, but in that case, how do you actually ever read anything out? And the answer is, well, you can now bias by applying a current bias through this source here. You essentially force the force gamma to change, and thereby you change delta away from zero. Now you have two states with different currents through. Remember, still no currents into the island, but two different currents across the island. So, and these then you can try to pick up by various means, and will come back later to a particularly effective bit.
So during that operation time, you lose sensitivity to environmental conditions. Or are you gaining sensitivity?
Yes, you would, but only for the time that you're actually doing
the operation.
Okay. Okay. So just, well, before I go on to the transmon, any questions about about quadrillion? I think it's rather ingenious design, and it has been quite widely used. This is perhaps the most widely used advanced design, I think, in the field of quantum information using superconducting qubits. This was first found quite late in the game, in 2007, Koch et al. The principle here is simply to take a simple charge qubit and shunt it with a rather large capacitance. Now, You remember that if, there's a term in the energy of a charged qubit, which involves the charge on the island. And again, hoping that I've got all the factors of two right, try to get them right. The effective term in the Hamiltonian is q squared over 2c minus q v sub g. And that is often expressed in the form of 2e squared over c. The 2 comes in because of, you're talking about Cooper pairs. And n now is the number of Cooper pairs, and ng is a sort of notional gate number, which is simply defined by this expression here. And then you have an extra constant, which you can forget about. So the total Hamiltonian now, for a more general situation than just a simple two-dimensional Hilbert space, is given by this expression here. And now you have, so you have this term which depends on n. N now does not have to be two neighbouring values. It can fluctuate more than that. So if you look at this term by itself, you get these discrete points here. Okay. And then you have your standard Jesus entanglement term. Now, in the original charged qubit experiments, as done by the Nakamura group, for example, the capacitance energy was... this looks like it's the wrong way round. This is the wrong way round. This should be EC much greater than EJ here. EC is much greater than EJ. That means that these dots, if you like, are very far apart. The Josephson energy is not enough in general to couple them. And so you could then truncate to the two lowest states. In the transmon, on the other hand, C is very large. So the capacitance energy tends to be much less than the Josephson energy. So at first sight, at least, phi is a well-defined variable, close to being a well-defined variable. Now, I think, just as is done in the original papers, it's interesting to make the analogy here to a simple quantum pendulum. In the quantum pendulum, you have a term, this is the standard gravitational potential energy here, that corresponds to the Josephson term here, but you also have a kinetic energy term, which depends on the angular momentum. And now, do you have any analogue of the n sub g, the gate voltage, number of charges on the gate, which is supposed to be the control parameter here? Do you have that in the pendulum case? And the answer is, well, you can always make one by essentially applying a vector potential to the... imagine your pendulum bob is charged, you apply a vector potential to it, and converting into the appropriate units, that precisely gives you a term of that form. So you do indeed have an exact analogy here. And the transmon situation corresponds to, in the pendulum, to the case where h bar omega, h bar times the small oscillation frequency here, is very much smaller than ngl. In other words, the ground state of your quantum pendulum is very well localized around the origin here. Now, of course, as usual, the problem is, if you really take that limit seriously, then you get back to your simple harmonic oscillator. However, the point is now you don't take it deadly seriously. You ask, okay, suppose that we now allow for small corrections to the simple harmonic oscillator picture. Then it turns out the saving point is the precise dependence on various quantities on the ratio EC over EJ in this limit that EC is much less than EJ. In other words, in the pendulum analogy, the case where the zero point energy here is very small compared to the energy necessary to get up here. And what turns out is that the anharmonicity goes as a power law of this ratio, EC over EJ, whereas the sensitivity to NG, or in the pendulum case, the sensitivity L sub J, is exponential. in this quantity here. And I think it's worth taking a moment to see why that's true. It's a rather generic point about the near classical limit of a quantum pendulum. Okay, so in the pendulum analogy, if you expand your potential near the minimum here, you get indeed the simple harmonic term, and then you get a quartic term and higher term. So the question is, how does that affect the energy levels? Well, the difference between... So you would expect, in general, that... this is exaggerated, but you would expect that the an anharmonic potential, like the cos theta one, the spacing of your levels is not constant. And the question is, how big is this difference here? Well, it's essentially... You would expect that the this difference here would be proportional to the expectation value of the fourth order term in your ground state wave function. But your theta squared here, the mean square value is something like this, and that means the theta to the fourth is roughly that square. Now, going back to our original problem, making these mappings from the pendulum to the Josephson qubit, you find that phi squared is of the order of EC divided by EJ, as you sort of crudely expect. So that means that the effect of the anharmonic terms, and therefore the difference between the splitting here and the splitting here, is indeed parallel in the ratios. Right. Okay, so far? Okay, now, I think perhaps more interesting is the question, what is the sensitivity to n sub g, or in the pendulum analogy, to the vector potential-like torque that occurs? Now, here's the interesting point. Suppose that you knew for sure, suppose you put some huge barrier, say, so that the pendulum could never rotate through d pi. Then you know for sure that you don't have to identify, remember this is a question we raised several times before, in that limit, you don't have to identify 0 and 2 pi. In other words, you don't have to impose the usual periodic boundary conditions on your wave function. That means, in turn, that the angular momentum, there's no basis for the quantization of angular momentum. And in that case, well, you've just got an L minus Lg squared term, remember, in your Hamiltonian. Basically, everything looks exactly the same as the simple harmonic oscillator. So the... so this is going to fail. This argument is going to fail to the extent that it is possible for the pendulum to rotate right around from 0 to 2 pi. But how? What's the amplitude for that? Well, this is in some sense a simple WKB-like problem. In the case of the pendulum, the amplitude to go from 0 to 2 pi is proportional to the WKB exponent for going all the way around. And that involves the barrier height, which is something like 2 mgl, here, divided by h bar omega, the ground state energy. However, going back again now to the Josephson problem, the barrier height is of the order of ej, actually twice ej. Omega is this quantity, this combination to the half over h bar. And so the amplitude for your phase to go from 0 to 2 pi is indeed exponentially small in this quantity. And therefore, the sensitivity with respect to your control parameter in G is again exponentially small in that. Now, okay, that argument is hand-waving, obviously. But Koch et al. Do indeed do a proper calculation of this involving Mathieu functions and all sorts of other complicated objects, and they indeed come up with this answer here. They find that the difference in splitting is indeed parallel. I think it's squared, but I don't remember exactly. It's squared in this ratio here. And they also find, more importantly, that the sensitivity to NG, parameterized by this difference here, is indeed exponentially small in this quantity. So, once I know that I can afford a certain, that I have to have, let us say, a certain minimum value of the difference in this in these two splittings here, and that of course is going to be controlled by my relaxation times and so forth, that'll set the limits that I can tolerate on that, then I can find a value of EC over EJ which is large enough, is small enough that the anharmonicity is still sufficient for, if EC divided by EJ is very small, then I'm in the strictly harmonic limit. Can't think this through my head. Anyway, we find a value of this quantity, which is in the right regime, so that I effectively suppress all the dependence on my NG. I suppress that exponentially, and at the same time, I get an adequate splitting here. That's the basic principle.
So if I go into this regime where my Cooper-Barabox Hamiltonian has a really really small Josen energy...
Small Josen energy, yes, Lord.
Then it seems like you said before, like my new quantized variable is not a phase instead of the number of charges built up on the island. It seems that N is no longer my quantum variable because it's not the dominant charge of my Hamiltonian. So my Hamiltonian is like quasi-diagonal in my phase basis.
I'm sorry, which limit were you thinking about?
In the transmon limit.
In the transmon limit where EJ is large.
It seems like the phase operator is the biggest part of my Hamiltonian, and thus if I was to diagnose my Hamiltonian, my magnitudes would be closer to my phase states than they would be to my number states.
Does that make sense?
So if I was to take that Hamiltonian they showed on the previous slide and try and truncate the first two levels of my phase, like I tried to truncate the phase operator to like two levels, you know what I mean? If I did two level parts of my Hamiltonian
basis,
what would that look like? Because my phase operator is like a continuous eigenspectrum.
Well, that's right. I mean,
does it make sense to truncate the two levels for the phase operator? Does that question make sense? Can you do that? In the same way that you truncated the two levels of the number operator, which is discrete. Makes a lot more sense.
No, I don't. No, I think you've always got to look on the phase as a continuous variable.
Okay.
The question is whether it's sort of relatively well defined, whether say its fluctuations are small compared to 2 pi.
So, what does that mean for my measurements and control now? What am I actually controlling in the transmon regime? Am I controlling the number of charges built up in the island or the phase across the junction?
Good question. Because of this very small sensitivity to NG, I cannot control at least in the original configuration. I can't control it by gate voltage. I could, however, control the strength of the Josephson tunneling term. For example, if as is usually the case, my junction is actually a DC squid, then I can control the strength of the Josephson coupling by varying the flux.
So I'm still going to control the number of charges built in the island. I can no longer do it through a bias voltage.
In the transmon limit, the number of charges on the island really is fluctuating by a large amount.
Right, that's what I thought. So then, what am I actually measuring in the transmon regime?
Good question. I guess that would depend on the specific readout setup that you have.
Okay.
By incorporating this in a larger circuit, you could convert the Josephson term into a current around that circuit, and then you could measure that.
Okay, through a flux readout or something, get the current going in the circle or something.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Fluxonium. Yes, this is perhaps not quite so important as the other two, but it has been used quite a bit in quantum information applications. To introduce fluxonium, this is the Yale group. Incidentally, of these advanced designs are due either to Yale, Sacre, or Berkeley. Let's digress for a moment to a simple LC circuit. Nothing fancy at all. You've just got a circuit with an inductance and a capacitance here. And the Hamiltonian for this circuit is of the simple harmonic oscillator type. The charging energy across the capacitor plates and the self-inductance energy related to the flux through the circuit here. And we argued previously that, well, we didn't do it specifically for this kind of situation, but it's a simple, simply transcribe it to this. We argued that there is this canonical commutation relation when you quantize your system, the canonical commutation relation between the charge and flux. So in other words, for example, you can look on the flux as corresponding to the x variable, q to the p variable. Let's introduce dimensionless quantities. So just take the flux in units of the flux quantum, take the charge in units of the Cooper pair charge. And then we get this result here. And we just get one energy associated with the dimensionless q squared, one with the dimensionless phi squared. And now the commutation relation is just this. Now the interesting question is, what's the ratio of the mean square values of q and phi in the ground state? This should be, this should really be a square on these two here. So mean square value. We know for sure that the energies in by equipartition, for the quantum case, we know that the energies, two energies, have to be equal and equal to a half of the zero point energy. In this case, the zero point energy is just half of h bar omega LC, standard frequency of an LC circuit. And so the ratio of the mean square fluctuations of flux to those of charge is EC over EJ. And now you can re-express that in terms of two quantities with the dimensions of impedance. One is the standard impedance of an LC circuit, given by this formula here. And the other is the so-called standard quantum unit of resistance. Well, careful here. People in mesoscopic physics usually define the unit of resistance as H over E squared, and then it's about 25 kilo-ohms. In the case of when it was dealing with superconductors, this is a more standard definition that comes out about 6 kilo-ohms. See, it's a standard quantum unit of resistance, and that, as many of you will know, that quantity plays an incredibly important role in discussion of issues like weak localization and so forth. But we're not interested in that right now, of course. Now, there's a rather general theorem of electrical engineering which says that for any kind of simple electrical circuit, that is, one which is simply composed of traditional capacitances, inductances, resistances, etc., the impedance should be less than or of the order of the vacuum impedance, which is 377 ohms. The argument the very hand-waving argument for that is that, crudely speaking, the capacitance must be at least of the order of epsilon zero times the maximum dimension. The inductance can't be larger than this, and therefore L over C has to be less than this, which gives you this result here. And so what we infer then is that the fluctuations of flux relative to those of charge are of the order of this ratio, which must be less than or of the order 4 times 10 to the minus 3. In other words, for any simple LC circuit in dimensionless units, you always have that the charge fluctuations are large compared to the fluctuations of flux. That in turn, moreover, since by the uncertainty, standard uncertainty relation, you know that the product of these two quantities must be of the order of one or greater. That then implies that the fluctuations in charge must always be large compared to one. Now, How do you get around this? Well, we get around this by the observation that if you have a Josephson system and you're talking about small fluctuations of phi around, say, zero, and just trying to make order of magnitude estimates, then a Josephson junction is equivalent to a nonlinear inductance. You have E, this is the standard formula for EJ, and if you expand that, you can write it in terms of phi there, and then convert the phase into a flux by the usual correspondence. Then, for example, if I were to put this in a flux qubit circuit, I would get this relation here. I find that the Josephson energy is given by this expression here, that then implies that I have an effective self-inductance which is proportional to 1 over 2 pi IC. That's rather interesting. Moreover, incidentally, I've just written this for the limit of small phi, so that it looks like the inductance is linear. But in fact, of course, if I increase phi, then the second derivative goes as cos phi. And so that means that my effective inductance for small oscillations around a non-zero value of phi are my effective inductance turns out to be a great deal larger than this. It's a strongly nonlinear inductance. But for now, we're just interested in the case of small fluctuations around zero. So LJ, then, is given by this expression here. And that means that, interestingly, a small value of critical current implies a large effective inductance. And therefore, it turns out, if I substitute my ordinary linear electromagnetic inductance by a Josephson junction, I can actually get values of L, which are very much larger than I would have got, simple circuit, and I can get values of the effective impedance of my circuit, which are actually much larger than R sub Q. So, and then, I can reduce the fluctuations of Q, which are essentially the Cooper pair number, to less than the order 1. Using that principle, a general principle, the Yale group constructed their what they call the fluxonium circuit, which is a sort of hybrid between charge and flux qubits. They take the standard flux qubit geometry, but now they shunt the geometrical, well, this is probably shouldn't call it geometrical, the intrinsic inductance of the Josephson junction. They shunt it by a large number of large Josephson junctions. Each of these junctions individually has a small Josephson induction, but they are in series, and therefore the total shunting inductance is large. So the advantage of that is that it gives you this this large shunting inductance, while at the same time the critical current of each of your junctions individually is large. That means you don't have to worry about getting any phase slips in these large shunting junctions. In this case, the EG EC ratio is much smaller than for typical flux qubits. On the other hand, the effective inductance is small compared to EJ. In fact, the values they give in their original experiment are these here. Now, this is an interesting case because now the structure of the energy levels differs from those of the standard flux qubit. For example, if the external flux is zero, remember, for standard flux qubit, we're usually interested in the case where the external flux is close to a half flux quantum. However, we can consider the case where the external flux is biased to zero. In that case, our energy level diagram is symmetric around zero. in a phi. And for the standard flux qubit, you get something looking rather like this. Lots of energy levels within each single well here. For fluxonium, it turns out that you get a structure which is much more like this. And then it turns out you can actually use, you could in principle use these two states here, but more likely you can use the even and odd parity states here as elements for a qubit. For example, I've drawn here a state which has some amplitude for occupation of each of these three lowest wells, and essentially no occupation for any higher wells. Now, I haven't actually put any signs on this. What I've drawn here is an even state, but equally there's going to be an odd state in which you have this this guy and this guy occupied and not much going on here, and so forth. So you can treat these as possible flux elements, and so forth. Okay. Now I want to go on to a rather important topic. So far we've essentially considered the Josephson, whatever Josephson system we're talking about, as in some sense isolated or at least embedded in a simple circuit. Now we're going to consider something a little more sophisticated, the subject of so-called circuit QED. Here are a couple of review articles on this. Let's just go back, digress for a moment, to consider a single cavity, and it could be normal or it could be superconducting, but at least in the atomic physics case, which I'm going to talk about for a moment, people usually use superconducting cavities simply because the dissipation can be reduced much, much more in the case of superconducting cavities. And we consider a case where we're only interested in a single cavity mode. Of course, in general, the cavity is going to have lots of modes, but there's going to be only one which is anywhere near resonant with the systems we want to consider. So if we have a cylindrical cavity here, then the electric for the mode we're interested in, the electric field is radially outwards, so we satisfy the boundary conditions on the side walls. We also have to satisfy them on the in walls, and that implies that the length must be an integral number of wavelengths, of half wavelengths. This taken to be the simplest case, half a wavelength. And then the frequency is just given by this. Now, I suppose we put in there a single atom. To the extent that we can make so-called rotating wave approximation, in other words, we can neglect the so-called counter-rotating component of the RF field, then our Hamiltonian is just the well-known James Cummings Hamiltonian. There's a term which involves the cavity modes here, just H omega times the number of cavity modes excited. There's the term corresponding to the atomic states, whose eigenstates now are the atomic energy levels. And then there's going to be the standard James Cummings Cummings term here. So we're interested in, crudely speaking, we're interested in processes in which I flip the spin of my qubit, and if I flip it downwards, then I create an extra photon, my cavity. If I flip it upwards, then I absorb one. It's very standard. So one question that arises is how large can this coupling constant G be? Well, G is simply given by the standard dipole expression, the atomic dipole matrix element times the electric field. Now, we can't do much about the dipole moment. It's essentially of the order of E times A0, where A0 is the Bohr radius. What about the electric field? Well, the electric field is given by this expression, because the integral of a half epsilon 0 times E squared is just the energy. So for a single photon, the effective electric field is given by that expression here. and you do a bit of algebra on that, and you find that because the, crudely speaking, because the energy density is going to be inversely proportional to the actual transverse dimension of the system, then it turns out that your field is proportional to r to the minus 1 times this expression here, where alpha is the final structure constant. So g over g divided by h, which should be h bar omega, g divided by h bar omega, which is the quantity we're most interested in, it gives you the...
Yeah.
What's r here? R is the transverse dimension. Okay. So the energy density is proportional to r to the minus 2, so e is proportional to r to the minus 1. So the result of, as a result of this calculation, you find that g divided by h bar omega is given by this expression here. But you see now, r can't possibly be less than the Bohr radius. That's not going to make any physical sense. And so we're restricted to values of this ratio which are less than the order of 0.1. That would be very optimistic, actually. In fact, in real life, as far as I know, the maximum value of this which has been obtained is something like 10 to the minus 6. On the other hand, that's one possible dimensionless ratio we're interested in. It's not the only one. In cavity QED, with traditional cavity QED with their atoms, people have been able to attain the so-called strong coupling limit, where G is large compared to the cavity loss. And that's already of considerable interest to get there, and people put a lot of work into doing that. You notice, incidentally, that in a QED cavity, and particularly if it's superconducting, provided the atomic transition is not too close to being on resonance with any of the cavity modes, which is of course something you can ensure by tuning your parameters right, then the actual spontaneous lifetime of atomic decay can be much increased relative to the free space value. The reason for that is sort of trivial. The atom can only decay if it can find the right photon to give up its energy to. If, however, in the cavity, the photon energies are very strongly quantized, so it may well not be an appropriate photon around. So this becomes important later when we talk about the superconducting qubit case. Okay, so let's now imagine that we replace the atom by a qubit, for example, a charged qubit or transmon. I've got to read my own writing here. We replace the cavity, for the moment at least, by an open transmission line. So a typical geometry might be something like this. Here are your transmission lines. Here's your Cooper pair box sitting out here. Suppose we just have, for the sake of argument, a simple charged qubit. Then we can take the basis as the eigenstates I don't know why I've got an HQ on here. The eigenstates of, I don't think I want that actually. I'm getting confused by my own notation. Q stands for qubit here, not for charge. Okay, so we're taking the basis as the eigenstates of the qubit Hamiltonian, and so at degeneracy, the eigenstates are given by this expression here. Now this means that although the expectation value of the dipole moment in either of these states individually is zero, the transition dipole matrix elements between these states is going to be large in general. In fact, the interaction Hamiltonian with the electromagnetic field is going to be given, as before, by the electric field times the dipole matrix element, and in this basis it's going to be proportional, I don't know if you can read that, to sigma x here. Sigma x and the coefficient is going to be essentially twice the electron charge, since we're talking about a Cooper pair, multiplied by the characteristic dimension of the physical Cooper pair box. This is implicitly assuming here, and I'm just doing a very hand wave, an order of magnitude estimate here, that's assuming that when the charge hops across from the bulk into the island, on here I haven't actually drawn the bulk and island explicitly, but when it hops across, that it's basically localized in the general volume of the box. And one can give arguments as to why that will happen. So now the important point to note is that the expectation value, or sorry, not the expectation value, the value of your transition dipole matrix element here is now several orders of magnitude larger than it was for a single atom. Simply because the dimension, the actual spatial dimension, are much greater. So in the rotating wave approximation, we recover the James Cummings Hamiltonian with, again, here's our cavity mode energy. Here is the, sorry, there's something missing here. There should be an EJ sitting on here times sigma Z. And then the standard James Cummings coupling two. Now, however, it's much easier to get large values of G. In fact, you very easily get to the point where you're in the strong coupling regime, where this is large compared to the cavity damping. And there's sort of two main regimes. When delta when the splitting is tuned to be small, so this order, then you can get vacuum Rabi splitting between states in which you have your qubit in the ground state and one photon. That'll be resonant with the state in which you have your qubit excited and zero photons, and so you get standard level crossing or Rabi splitting effects. The opposite limit, where you've detuned far away from resonance, so that you've got this expression here, that's the so-called strongly dispersive regime, and by doing second-order perturbation theory in G, you then get an effective interaction, which is now proportional to sigma Z. So crudely speaking, you get a virtual process in which you start off with the qubit in its ground state, let us say, and n photons in your cavity. It'll then absorb virtually a photon going into the excited state, then back down again. And that's going to give you a correction to your energy, which is proportional to the, sorry, which depends on the state in which you started. So that'll give you a sigma z term, which is proportional, interestingly, to the number of photons in the cavity. And that is actually rather nice, because what that means is, well, it's rather nice and rather a nuisance at the same time. What it means is that if you can measure now the number of photons in your cavity, which you can think of ways of doing, then that'll give you a way of measuring the state of your qubit. It also means, unfortunately, that fluctuations in the photon number can be strongly dephasing. There's an interesting alternative design, which very schematically goes something like this. You put a flux qubit in, and now, rather than coupling to the electric field of your of the cavity mode, you couple to the magnetic field. And so very crudely now, the interaction is proportional to the flux through your qubit multiplied by the magnetic field of the cavity mode. That gives you, again, a Hamiltonian of this form here. We're now, this is a little more flexible now, in the sense that I've now allowed my flux not necessarily to be exactly, my external flux through my qubit, flux qubit circuit, not necessarily to be simply equal to phi 0 over 2. If it is, in fact, equal to phi 0 over 2, then this essentially reduces to the charged qubit case with appropriate transformation of my axes. So in the rotating wave approximation, again we get back to the James Cummings Hamiltonian. However, in this case, G can turns out to be even larger than it could be for the standard setup. And in fact, there have been experiments in which G has actually been made larger than H bar omega 0 1. So this is really a very strongly non-perturbative regime, and quite interesting in its own right. Okay. Okay, now, there have been some really rather interesting developments in the last couple of years or so in improving the circuit QED design. These two papers, I think, are particularly significant in that respect. Okay. So what these people did was to take a transmon qubit, and you remember that previously we assumed that it was simply next to a one-dimensional transmission rod. And that was, in fact, the original geometry used in circuit QED. However, these people decided that rather than doing that, they would actually embed their qubit in a three-dimensional superconducting box, just as in the original atomic physics experiments, in fact. So they found, and at least in the case of Rigetti et al., I forget whether Pike et al. Did the same, they actually didn't use a superconducting box, they used a normal metal copper box. Luckily, by the time you get down to these sort of temperatures, which is the order of, say, 20, 25 millik, at which you usually operate these things, the conductivity of normal copper, reasonably pure normal copper, is so high that it's effectively equivalent to a superconductor for practical purposes. It turns out, luckily, it's much easier to cool. Remember, you've got quite a large box of this stuff. It's not that trivial to cool it down to 25 millik. Because of the decreased specific heat of superconductors, it's much more difficult to cool a large superconducting box down. So I think that's why they did it. They got really much improved values of T1 and T2. Now, one factor, I owe this to Paul, who informed me about it, is that the geometry of the the box is now such that the coupling of the electric field to surfaces which can host nasty things like two-level systems and so forth is a great deal smaller than in the original design. At the same time, you get better shielding from stray external radiation, and as we'll see in a minute, this is something you can't really afford to neglect in these experiments. These people speculate that the ability to cool all 4π, as it were, of the environment down to 25 millik or whatever it was, 10 millik, I think, in their case, was a great advantage. This may have helped a lot. One question, which one I think can raise, although I don't think, as far as I recollect, it's not raised explicitly in either of these papers, is at what point, if we go on doing this, are we going to get into trouble with, or at what point, sorry, that's not the right word, at what point is the question of free space, electric dipole decay, going to become an issue? Because that's something you see which, so far at least, in the case of Joseph Simon qubits, people have really, I think, not worried about a lot. You remember that, quite generally, the free space radiation rate, that's essentially going to be effectively T1 to the minus 1, proportional to the dipole matrix element squared times the transition frequency cubed. It's a very standard theory, standard formula of atomic theory. Now, let's think about for a moment the 2p. This should be 2p, sorry, not 2s. 2p goes to 1s transition of the hydrogen atom, the fundamental line. For that, you find that the frequency is about 2 times 10 to the 15 hertz, and we find experimentally that the value of the decay rate is 6 times 10 to the 8 per second. Compare that now with a charged qubit in a cavity. let's say, this is probably a little optimistic, as it were, that's probably on the high side. But, let's suppose that the frequency is the order of 20 gigahertz. In real life, it tends to be more sort of 5 to 10 gigahertz, but let's just take this for a moment. Then the omega cubed factor relative to the atom will reduce the rate by 10 to the 15. However, the dipole moment now, as we previously remarked, is of the order of 2L over A0, the 2 for the Cooper pair, relative to the H atom. So if D is, say, 10 microns, which perhaps a little optimistic, not very, then that actually increases the rate by 2 times 10 to the 11. Therefore, if you just make this hand-waving order of magnitude estimate, you'd say that the gamma due to electric dipole moment effects, electric dipole radiation, is something like this, which turns out to be about 10 to the 3 seconds to the minus 1. Now that's interesting because, T1 to the minus 1, T1 should be 1 millisecond. That's interesting because, as we'll see, the measured T1s in some of these experiments are approaching something like 0.1 milliseconds. And therefore, it's conceivable that this could already be playing a role in the improvement in going from a one-dimensional to a three-dimensional situation. You see, by going from one dimension to three dimensions, one of the things you've done is to freeze out the possible modes of the radiation field, and therefore to decrease the probability of decay in this way. A number of other recent improvements, in particular, going either improving the quality of your junction itself. Remember, typically the sort of Josephson junctions which are normally used in this game are aluminum oxide, and they are prone, as we, there's now a lot of evidence for this, they're very prone to contain two-level systems. There's pretty direct evidence now for that hypothesis from the experiments of John Martinez and his group. They've actually been able to do quite elegant resonance experiments showing the two-level nature of these systems. So I think there's no doubt they're there. So obviously one question is the question of materials engineering. How do you get rid of them? And indeed the Martinez group has improved a lot in that respect in the last few years. The other possibility, of course, is to use another material for your junction, and titanium nitride appears to be a nice thing to use. It doesn't appear to have too many of these two-level systems in it. So people are getting better and better at controlling the various sources of decoherence. Unfortunately, the more you get rid of one kind of source of decoherence, the more you get hit by another one. It turns out that there's now considerable evidence that one mechanism of decoherence, which we'd until now pretty much forgotten about, is normal quasar particles. Well, you say to yourself, wait a moment. In an earlier lecture, I told you that if I take my say a 1 cm³ block of niobium down to 10 millik and look at the thermal equilibrium state, I told you the number of not the fraction, the number of normal quasar particles was zero, more precisely 10 to the minus dot dot dot. So how come they can be playing a role? Well, unfortunately, there always are going to be various sources of stray background radiation, however much you would like to get rid of them. And in the most recent experiments, it looks as if a few normal quasar particles are created by this external radiation. They then can tunnel across the junction. Now, when they tunnel, they're normal quasar particles. They're not tunneling by the Josephson mechanism. So they are effectively forming a shunting resistance, or shunting conduct, more like appropriately shunting conductance. And that then is a known source of decoherence. And so it looks, in fact, in some of these, the very, very most recent experiments, the last few months or so, it does look as if this is really playing a quite substantial role. Very luckily, it also turns out that there are ways of dealing with this. You can, for example, you've created a normal quasar particle. Some background stray background radiation has come in, created one or more normal quasar particles. They're going to be highly deleterious to you if you don't get rid of them. Moreover, there's another point which has become rather obvious in recent times. They're very, very long-lived. In fact, if I really had an isolated box and I had one extra quasar particle in it, I would never get rid of it because the total number of particles is conserved, and so I'm always going to have that extra quasar particle there. It's always going to be rattling backwards and forwards. And although it's only one of it, it's still important. So the question is, how do you get rid of these unwanted objects? And one possibility is that you actually provide deliberately an extra superconductor of a different system which has a smaller gap than in the bulk, and then hopefully the quasar particle will prefer to go off and sit in that metal rather than in the one you're interested in. Another rather amusing observation which has been made in the last couple of years is that, again, thank Paul for this, draw my attention to this. The Devereux group has found that if you apply a relatively weak magnetic field to your system, but enough to create, and it's the right kind of system, you can create vortices. And then it appears that the quasar particle is really rather attracted by the vortex and likes to go and sit in it. So again, it doesn't do you any harm. Okay, this is a new source of decoherence, but there are also ways of getting rid of it. Just finally, let me just show you a few numbers. What happened? I thought I had here... Oh, no, I had a table here somewhere. Here we are. Okay, that's what I mean. Okay, so thinking for the moment just about single qubits, not about, entangled pairs or whatever, let's just ask, what are the best current parameter values we can get? I think it's correct to say, again, I might be wrong because these new things are coming out every month, that the best value for T star 2 is this one, the one of Rigetti et al. A couple of years ago, about 92 microseconds, so nearly 0.1 milliseconds here. That's for T star 2. They didn't actually, as far as I know, do a spin echo experiment to measure the intrinsic T2. T1 is something like 70 microseconds here. Now, that is not by any means the longest value that people have found for T1. These guys, again, I think that's the Yale group, might be Cyclone, I forget. They took fluxonium in a 3D cavity at the sweet spot where most of your decoherence mechanisms go away, and they actually found a value of T1 close to this is very close to specific values of the parameters. It's not a generic statement about the system. But they did find a value of T1 which is as long as 8 milliseconds. They didn't measure either T2 or T star 2, so we don't know what that was. But this is showing you roughly the order of magnitude. Well, just very crudely, for comparison, what do you expect to be your operating frequency, as it were? Well, it's certainly can't be shorter than the inverse of the characteristic splitting, of your circuit, which tends to be somewhere in the region of a few gigahertz, and so forth. So very crudely speaking, you're now getting factors of the order of 10 to the 4 in your figure of merit, which is, crudely speaking, of course, the operating frequency times the T2 here. And this table, this is a slightly more detailed table, which you probably can't read, I'm afraid. I certainly can't read it, but maybe your eyes are better than mine. I just took this table from the Devereux-Shulkov article, which is pretty much up to date. And crudely speaking, here they're plotting what you would like to have for various quantities, various parameters regarding the operation of the system. Here is what we actually have, and you can see that in many cases, in some cases they're better than these desired numbers. In many cases, they're still maybe an order of magnitude or so on.
I don't know understand, what are the units?
Sorry?
What are the units on this table? Like, what are they, the number of operations total?
Okay, I'm afraid I would have to go back to the their table caption for that, but yes, they actually do go into some detail defining what exactly they mean.
Sure.
Yep. Okay, and you see, one interesting thing is that the fidelities which you get for various kinds of operation you're talking about here are actually getting quite good, something like 0.98, 0.99, and so forth. So at least at the single qubit level, it looks as if superconducting qubits are becoming real players in the quantum information game. Now, next time, we'll have to go on and see what has been done, so try to see what's been done so far in coupling qubits together, entangling them, and so on and so forth. And of course, that's some of these figures then may not then turn out to be that meaningful in that context. But at least this is a sort of starting point for discussion. Okay. I think I probably should stop at this point because the
when you read these papers, they tell you some of the kind of Deboré and Chalkov, they tell you what's great about this superconducting qubit. But if you ask the question, what do you think is the biggest weakness?
What's the biggest weakness? I would think right now the biggest weakness is clearly the decoherence times, which are several orders of magnitude worse than they are, for example, for nuclear spins or trapped ions, so forth. In the future, but on the other hand, I think one should say that what was T2 way back in 1999? I mean, it was something like a nanosecond. It's now improved to getting on for 0.1 milliseconds. So that's a pretty good improvement over 15 years. So I think, and they make this comment, that there doesn't seem to be any intrinsic reason why you can't get things down considerably below this. So I think decoherence may not in the end turn out to be the most serious defect. I suspect it's going to be more the question of actually doing the wiring and avoiding crosstalk and so forth. But in some sense, you could say, well, that's a problem that classical electrical engineers have had to face for a long time. So we've at least got a toolbox of skills to deal with that. I'll try to talk a little the next time about what Deveraux and Chalkov, and I think I sort of agree with them, see as the main advantages of qualitative advantages of superconducting qubits. Okay, I think so. Let's stop at this point then, and I'll see you again here on Thursday morning, the same time. As I say, I'll try to discuss. Well, I'll probably try to start actually by discussing something which really, in some sense, doesn't have very much directly to do with superconducting qubits, but has been extremely useful in that area, and that's the question of the Josephson bifurcation amplifier. It's actually a classical device, but it is used to measure qubits in a rather nice way, and I'd like to say a little, at least a little about that. And then I'll go on to talk about how you couple qubits together, what people have done with them.